This time we're going to hear from someone who has devoted a lifetime of service to railroad workers and their families. Our speaker began his career in 1974 with the Norfolk and Western Railroad and held numerous positions in that railroad's signal department. In 1990, he was elected to the office of General Chairman on the NS for the Brotherhood of Railroad Signalmen. In 1999, this brother was elected to serve as National Secretary Treasurer of the BRS, an office he continued to hold until October of 2011, when he was sworn in as the labor member of the United States Railroad Retirement Board. Brothers and sisters, please give a warm welcome to one of the biggest supporters the BLET has ever had, Brother Walt Barrows.
Thank you, President Pierce, for those kind words. Officers, delegates, guests, thank you for the opportunity to come here today and just spend a few moments with you to talk to you about rare retirement. Throughout the year, I get the opportunity to address a lot of groups. And as Dennis said, I'm a signalman, and that's kind of my home. But my second home is with the BLET, I have to tell you that. This union is very special to me. It's special to me because in my work experience, in my 30-plus years as an officer in our union, I had many occasions to work closely with the BLET on national issues of health care and in rural retirement and national negotiations. But beyond that, and I've told this story before, and I'll just kind of briefly tell it again, your union is special to me because I feel indebted to your union. Indebted to something that happened 61 years ago. You see, 61 years ago, a widow in Cleveland, Ohio, needed some help. And she went to the headquarters of the BLE. She asked for their help to get a widow's pension she was entitled to, something she didn't have an entitlement to when her husband died 12 years earlier. Her husband was a coach cleaner, not an engineer, but that didn't matter. The BLET or the BLE at that time reached out and helped her. Helped her because she was a railroad widow and she needed help. They got her that benefit and it made a difference in her life. That widow was my grandmother. You know, the BLET has been a leader in protecting and improving rural retirement. It understands the value of these benefits. It understands that it takes strong leadership and member activism to protect our retirement system against those who would threaten it. BLET has a real voice in the workplace, a real voice in Washington, D.C. Your leadership is recognized both on the property and in the halls of Congress on Capitol Hill. It's clear your union has long been a guardian of rare retirement. I say that because your union was on the cutting edge in the 19th century when they first established private pensions in the railroad system. Those were the foundations that rail retirement was built off of. Let me start with this question. How many of you went to work on the railroad with a plan to have millions of dollars when you retire? How many? Oh, there's a couple. I didn't. Glad you guys were more visionary than I was. I was hoping to get my pickup paid for when I started. Well, I'm going to talk to you about just such a plan. A plan that's been there, and it's been for me and for you and for all railroad workers, has been building. A plan that will actually have millions of dollars for you. You see, our chief actuary estimates that the average railroad worker who retired at age 60, now that worker has about 38 years service on average, that worker and their spouse will receive a railroad retirement benefit that pays out over their lifetime over $2 million. Over $2 million in benefits. That's significant. It's something I didn't think would ever be there for me when I went to work on the railroad. And I'm gonna work hard and have worked hard to protect that, and I think you will too. In addition to a retirement benefit that you'll receive millions from, rural retirement protects you when you're disabled. It protects your survivors if you should pass before they. Our occupational disability program is superior to any disability program for American workers. It is a protection that many workers in America would love to have and don't have. You see, a career railroader with at least 20 years service, or age 60 with at least 10 years service, and can no longer do their regular railroad occupation, will receive a full unreduced retirement benefit. You don't have to, like other workers, go out and find another job, some sedentary work. If you can't do your railroad job, you don't have to do another railroad job. If you can't do your railroad job, we're going to pay you a full unreduced retirement benefit. That's a great benefit. We also have superior survivor benefits. Let me explain to you about that. You see, most retirement plans, when you want a survivor benefit, you have to elect for that. That's what I have in the federal government I work at now. When I retire, if I want a benefit for my spouse, if she survives me, I have to make an election when I retire. And that election means I'm going to take a reduced benefit for those years. Not so with rural retirement. You see, with rural retirement, we pay a full survivor benefit without election or reduction in your benefits. Your retirement benefits are among the best, if not the best, in America. Now, the benefits I highlighted are significant. And I could go on because there's many more benefits. But you should know this. They did not always exist. They weren't just given to us. We had to fight hard for these. Our predecessors fought hard for these. You see, the first law passed in 1934 after the collapse of the U.S. economy and the private pension funds that railroad workers had limited coverage under. The first law went into being in 1934, but that wasn't the end. That was just the beginning of the fight. Immediately, the railroads went to court. They went to the courts to fight and challenge that law. In similar fashion to the kind of things we're hearing today out of the courts, the Supreme Court sided with the railroads. In a 5-4 decision, they ruled in 1934 that the 1934 Railroad Retirement Act was unconstitutional. The unions went back to Congress. The next year, they passed another law. This new law, when it was passed, it didn't stop the challenge of the railroads. Once again, the railroads weren't happy with the railroad retirement system, went back to court again, challenging the 1935 law. And the courts now, in a split decision in 1934, said some of the law was constitutional, while other parts were unconstitutional. 1936, a union-friendly president, a worker-friendly president, and that's important, demanded that the industry work out its differences with labor. That's how we got where we're at. You see, that agreement between labor and management enacted in the 1937 amendments to the Railroad Retirement Act became the basis for our retirement system today. Many of the benefits we take for granted, though, weren't there. That initial law didn't have the ability to retire at age 60 with 30 years. It didn't have a spouse benefit. It didn't have a monthly survivor benefit. It didn't have disability benefits. Those were not a part of that 1937 amendments. Those benefits were added years later. And many times, like the initial law, over the strong objections of the industry, we had a fight every time to improve our benefits. It never came easy. And over time, we even had to fight Congress and the president. In fact, one of our changes to our law was vetoed by President Ford. It was only an override of that veto that got us the 1974 Act and our changes then. The long history of rail retirement and rail labor has been a hard fight to establish the benefits, a hard fight to protect the benefits. You have earned everything you're going to get from rail retirement. You've earned it. This is not something the railroad gave us. It's not some entitlement like some welfare program some people like to say it is. Nothing can be further from the truth. This is a benefit you have worked for, you have sacrificed for. In fact, your families know the sacrifices you've made. They've experienced it, the long times away from home, the family events you've missed, the working conditions you've endured. Those are all part of your contribution to your retirement. They're all part of what you've earned. Also, you've made contributions to rail retirement. That same worker that's going to draw $2 million, it's estimated about $200,000 in taxes were contributed to that benefit. Even the railroad industry, who claims about their contribution, and they'll always make note of the contribution they made, that was not from the executives of the railroad. That came from capital earned by you. You see, the railroad profits are based on your work and your labor and your sacrifice, not on what some executive says he's done. Don't let anyone ever deny that you've earned every penny of your retirement. You know, with so many pension funds failing, you might ask, how secure is the future of our retirement? That's a reasonable question. So let me talk to you about that. First, let me remind you this. We are a pay-as-you-go system. We're not fully funded. Similar to Social Security, we are dependent on current payroll taxes and our trust fund balances to pay out retirement benefits. Those are key factors in our future funding, payroll taxes and our trust fund. The good news is, in June of this year, the Chief Actuary of the Railroad Retirement Board issued his 27th actuarial evaluation. He reports that absent some very catastrophic and pessimistic employment assumptions, railroad retirement is secure for 75 years. Under that most pessimistic employment assumption, something we've never had in our history, he says that we run out of money in 2047. But let me give you some historical context to those assumptions. There's three employment assumptions made by our chief actuary in every actuarial evaluation. In the past, we've always tracked the most optimistic assumption, never tracked the most pessimistic assumption. Give me an example. 2007, in 2007 actuarial report, the most optimistic assumption at that time, 10 years ago, 11 years ago, was that in 2018, we would have 224,000 workers and a trust fund balance of $19 billion. Today, we have about 224,000 workers and a trust fund balance that exceeds $28 billion, far exceeding his most optimistic assumptions 10 years ago. Our 2001 amendments to the Railroad Retirement Act established the private investment of our trust fund. That has performed as expected. Since the private investment of our trust fund dollars, we have seen annual returns on our investments double what our previous investment arrangements were. See, prior to that arrangement, we were only allowed to invest our funds in U.S. Treasuries, the same as Social Security. Since inception, our annual return now in the trust fund is 7.4%. And what makes that significant is that's happened during a period in time where we saw the greatest decline and collapse in our markets outside of the Great Depression. So we weathered the 2008 and 2009 collapse in the markets and came out of it on the other side with a 7.4% annualized return since 2001. That's good, very good. In fact, our trust fund now is in the best financial position it's ever been in its history. So financially, we are well off. Well, what else has happened with the trust fund? It started off with $21 billion, just to give you some numbers here. Today we got $28 billion in assets, and they've given us $21 billion back to pay benefits. That's a $28 billion return in investment since 2001. So, how stable are we? I think we're very stable. I think those stable employment numbers that we're seeing, the healthy trust fund balance, it demonstrates that our retirement system is positioned well for a strong future. I think it's something we need to make sure people know. You see, these projections are important. They're important to current retirees, they're important to future retirees. But they also inform us of this, that we need to continue to send a strong message, a strong and clear message to those in Washington, D.C., those who have their hands on the lever of power, those who could be a threat to us. We need to tell them our system is strong and solvent, and keep your damn hands off our retirement system. Railroad retirement is an American success story, really unlike any other. So with that good news, let us not forget that we've had a history of challenges. As I said earlier, we fought for everything we've ever had. And we continue to face challenges. We've faced them throughout our history. We'll face them in our future. Over the past several years, our significant challenge has been in our administrative funding. Those are the funds that we use to operate the agency on a day-to-day basis. Those are the funds that deliver the benefits on a timely manner, answer the questions you have, and service you and your members. So what are we seeing? We're seeing service declines, waits getting longer, calls getting harder to get through. We've had to close our field offices on Wednesday afternoon for the first time in our history to try to catch up on work. Our toll-free number, instead of reaching simply an office or a couple office, now rolls all the way across the country trying to find somebody that's not on a phone that can answer the phone. We now answer about 700,000 calls a year and have about 60,000 people walk into our offices to meet us. At the same time, we've seen a 15% decline in the last 2 years in the staffing of our field offices. An example of those staffing needs are best demonstrated and illustrated in the most busiest or the busiest rail corridor in the United States. Currently, we only have one person to man our office in Baltimore and two people to man our offices in Philadelphia. Think about that. Three people to service the rail population between Newark, New Jersey, and Richmond, Virginia, the busiest rail concentration of rail workers in the United States. While we're hopeful to get some more people in those offices, that is a direct result of a Congress and a White House that refuses to fully fund our operations. They have undercut our ability to deliver the services you paid for and you deserve. And by the way, where's that money come from? Well, it doesn't come from your neighbor's tax dollars. It comes from your payroll taxes and your trust fund. We don't use general revenue tax dollars for anything. We use trust fund monies and payroll taxes to fund the operations and the benefits. So you paid for these, and we should have the right to have service you've earned. Another glaring example of underfunding of our operations is demonstrated in our disability cases. It's a shame the situation we find ourselves in. The average wait for a disability case now is over 330 days, 11 months. 11 months, a railroad worker finds himself without income or ability to take care of their family's daily needs. Many workers are put in very tenable situations without income for something they didn't plan or something they didn't expect. But while this should be unacceptable to anyone and everyone, it seems that the congressional majority and the White House don't seem to be moved by these shameful statistics. The continuing scrutiny of an inspector general who seems bent on destroying rail retirement instead of helping, congressional oversight committees who are full of unwarranted criticism only add to the difficulty of trying to provide services in a timely manner. That's our challenge today, but we have some future challenges, some things I think we really need to keep on our radar screen, some things maybe you haven't even thought about. Well, let me talk to you about those. Future challenges include talk of changes to Social Security retirement and disability. Well, you say, wait, I'm not covered by Social Security retirement or disability, I'm covered by rail retirement. It's true. But many of the changes that are proposed under the Social Security system are mirrored by our system, and by law must be mirrored by our system. So let me just talk to you about a few of those. The House majority and the Senate majorities making these changes would impact our programs and your ability to collect the benefits you've earned. Let me give you one example. One's called CPI, chained CPI. It's a change in the CPI formula. Currently, the CPI is measured by a basket of goods, and they're measured every month to see what that basket of goods either goes up and down. So for example, currently, if beef is in that basket of goods and the price of beef goes up, you'd get an increase in the cost of living, meaning you would get more money in your retirement the next year to pay for the increased cost. But that's not what the conservatives see. The conservative think tanks come up with this new COLA system. It's called a substitution COLA. And what that does, what it does is it takes that beef that went up in price, and it takes it out of the basket and puts in the basket chicken. So voila, cost of living didn't go up because now you're eating chicken instead of beef. And it goes on and on and on. I don't know where that ends. I don't know if that ends where you're finally eating dog food or what, but it really becomes a problem when they start substituting what are costs. It is not a way to measure cost of living. In fact, if you ask current retirees, does the current cost of living system keep up with their cost of living? They will tell you no, because it undermeasures health care. The current system does not weight health care as much as retirees have a weight on health care for their cost. Calculations show that this new CPI, if enacted, and they're working hard to enact it, actually they're measuring some things with it right now, if enacted, would reduce benefits by 10% over the lifetime of retiree. Every retiree, like I said, will tell you the current doesn't keep pace. Reducing it by 10%, no matter how you spin it, and they try to spin it every way you can, no matter how you spin it, changing the CPI is a cut in benefits, both the Social Security and rare retirement. That's unacceptable, cutting our benefits. By law, rare retirement must use the same CPI as Social Security, so those changes would pass right on through to us. Another proposal would increase the minimum retirement age. Well, under our law, we have the 60-30 provisions. Those would not be affected by any changes in the Social Security retirement age. But it would affect our trust fund balances and our future funding needs, and would affect those who are not age 60 with 30 years service. Now, currently, we mirror Social Security for those with less than 30 years service, and I assume changes to retirement age would also mirror our retirement system when it comes to those with less than 30 years service. On top of that, part of our funding comes from Social Security to pay benefits they would otherwise have to pay. Let me try to briefly explain that to you without confusing you and give you an example. Last year, we paid $12 billion out in benefits. Of that $12 billion we paid out in benefits, Social Security Administration gave us $7.2 billion. Because those are benefits that Social Security would have had to pay. So let me give you an example. If you retire at age 60 with 30 years service, Social Security does not have anything like that, so we pay the entire 60-30 benefit. When you reach age 62, Social Security will be required to pay part of your Tier 1 benefit, so Social Security gives us that money. If you change the retirement age, it means more times we'll have to fund those benefits out of our dollars instead of Social Security exchanging dollars with us. So increasing retirement age would affect our funding of our trust system. Another place is changes to Social Security disability. Social Security disability would most likely pass through to our rare retirement total disability program. That's significant, and that's because 80% of railroad workers who go out on disability are deemed totally disabled, or we call it a disability freeze, meaning they fall under the same definition of disabled as the Social Security has. The White House has proposed cuts to that program totaling $70 billion. When the director of OMB, Mick Mulvaney, was asked, wouldn't it be a cut in Social Security if people's disability benefits were cut? He says, no, that's not, people don't expect that as part of their Social Security. When asked, won't people lose benefits as a result of this proposal? He says, I hope so. This will impact our funding of our disability benefits. Again, because there's some exchange of funds between us and Social Security, it would also impact our eligibility for those benefits who need the total disability. House leadership has proposed other changes that will affect us. They propose changes to Medicare. Those changes to Medicare would take what is now a low-cost, single-payer government system, the most efficient and cheapest delivery of health care in our country. That's not good enough. What they want to do is take that away and make it a for-profit insurance program, giving you vouchers to go out in the private insurance market to fend for yourself. Ask any retiree if that's what they want to do. If they want to move away from Medicare and move into the private insurance markets, fending for themselves. You see, on the current Medicare program, and what it pays, it's estimated that a retired couple will need $270,000 of medical costs during their retirement years. So your $2 million, you better hold some of that back for Medicare or medical costs. The conservative House proposals that would change our Medicare system would double those costs, meaning that retired couple would now need over $500,000 during their retirement years just to fund their unfunded medical needs. Railroad workers are covered under the same Medicare program as everybody else. Any changes to that would automatically affect us. Let us not forget the federal courts. We've heard something about them today and their potential impact. Let me give you an example that happened just this year. This year, Supreme Court decision, 5-4, you've heard those before, those numbers, 5-4, authored by Justice Gorsuch, said that for the first time in our 83-year history, that payments made in the form of railroad stock are not taxable under the Railroad Retirement Tax Act. So the millions of dollars that railroad executives get, and there's some stock paid to railroad workers, not as much as the executives, I will tell you that, those stocks are no longer taxable for railroad retirement. What's that mean? It means less money in our trust system. Let me give you another example that's going on in the courts, similar case. Last year, the 8th Circuit Federal Court of Appeals out of Omaha, Nebraska, ruled that ratification lump sum payments are no longer taxable under the Railroad Retirement Tax Act. Supreme Court this year has decided to hear another case. They've scheduled a case this year to hear the taxability of lost time due to on-job injuries. What's that all mean? Well, if you're the railroad, it means more money in your pocket. If you're a railroad worker, it means less money in your trust fund to pay for your benefits. As I said earlier, we're a pay-as-you-go system. We depend on payroll taxes. But we seem to be in a system now in our courts where taxes are a wrong thing and everything we can do to undermine them. So either lower employment or lower taxes both affects the income to our trust system and negatively affects our ability to pay benefits. Because of that recent decision, that 5-4 decision we got in June at the end of the session, we're still trying to work through these numbers, but it appears right now we're going to have to refund $250 million to the railroads and railroad workers. $250 million of our trust fund going back to the railroads out of our trust fund balances. That doesn't even count what we're going to lose going forward. That's significant. Those are some of the challenges I see us facing. So, let's talk about what do we do to protect our $2 million. I think everybody wants to protect it. Those who wanted to be millionaires when they retired, those who didn't know they were going to be millionaires when they retired, those who know they are now, I think want to make sure it's going to be there for them. So what do we do to protect it? I think you've heard a little bit of it this morning. To protect it, I think you need to vote for state, local, and federal office holders who understand the workers, understands our needs, who will stand with us and protect our benefits. Not just say they will, but will stand with us and protect our benefits. That's first. To protect it, we need to fight for the rights to form and maintain strong unions. You see, a strong union is the foundation that got us these benefits. A strong union is the foundation that protects these benefits. We need to oppose laws that undermine those rights, like these freeloader laws called right to work. We need to stop those kind of actions that undermine our ability to protect our benefits like railroad retirement. To protect your $2 million, we need to demonstrate through member activism, we need to do that by enlisting our coworkers. First, we need to make sure we're in it, and we need to get our coworkers in it. We need to get our families in the fight. We need to get our friends in the fight. You see, this is not a spectator fight. This is a fight we're in. If you're not in the fight, you've given up on your $2 million. And I think you all want to not give up on your $2 million. We need to be in the game as a fighter, not a spectator. To protect it, we need politicians to know clearly that we have earned the right to these benefits. These are valuable benefits we will fight like hell to protect, and that we will do something that maybe we haven't done before. That is, we will put aside single issues that divide us. We will put aside those issues they've used to divide us and demonstrate we will stand together to protect our benefits no matter what. Let me quote from one of Aesop's fables. Maybe you've heard some of these. A man came into a forest and asked the great trees to provide him with a handle for his axe. The tree consented to his request, gave him a young ash sapling. No sooner had the man fitted the new handle to his axe than he began to use it and quickly felled the great giants of the forest. An old oak, lamenting the destruction of his companions, said to the neighboring cedar, "We are undone, but we have only ourselves to blame. If we'd not given up the rights of the young ash, we might have retained our privilege and stood for ages." You see, the benefits in the future of our program will be dependent on strong labor unions. Strong labor unions are dependent on member activism. It's not just about leadership, it's about membership. Understand that the labor movement is trying to be undermined today. You've heard that said up here many times today. So many in our country are working so hard to undo what so many have worked so hard to put in place. We need to fight that. We need to fight that if we're going to protect our benefits like rare retirement. If we don't, they'll be weakened or diminished or worse off, gone altogether. It depends on workers standing together to defend even the weakest among us, standing together to defend even the widow who comes to your door and asks for help. You see, it doesn't matter if you're a union worker or a non-union worker, a public worker, a private worker, all workers share a common cause. We have a single issue. It's time for us to come together as workers to fight for fair wages, affordable health care, retirement security. This needs to be our single issue where we can't be divided on. We cannot stand by. We cannot stand by as others are sacrificed, because it will affect us. It has affected us, and it will affect us. Workers' rights are weakened by anti-worker federal judges, by anti-worker elected officials, and by powerful corporate interests, all out to weaken our rights. They affect each and every one of us. Even if the attack is not directly on us, it is an attack on us. If we want to protect our future, if we want our $2 million benefit to be there when we retire, we must see an attack on any worker as an attack on us. We must stand up for them if we want them to be there to stand up for us. You see, if we don't, one day we'll be like that great oak tree who said we only have ourselves to blame. Thank you.